Hey guys, thanks so much for listening. If you'd like to support us, please go to patreon.com/Frightday.
What, Kelly wants to start? Is that what you're tapping for? All right. You sure you're ready to go?
Yes.
All right.
Frightday.
I'm your host, Byron, and tonight, infertility turns to desperation, desperation to ignorance. But what happens next? Find out tonight as we review Ali Abbasi's Shelley, and implants, burns, missing time, and free rides. This is a big one.
If you could see Kelly grinning.
We're talking a few famous tales of alien abduction. In this week's edition of Kelly's Cryptids and Conspiracies, I'm joined tonight by Kelly.
Hi, guys.
And Sam.
Hey, guys.
Her face.
I don't know.
Oh, my God.
She's been honestly stuck like this since you told her we could do an episode about alien abductions.
Hey, guys.
Hey, are you all right?
I'm good.
Kelly's eyes are bugging out of her head.
I'm good.
Her cheeks are rosy.
I usually look towards her, but I'm going to stare straight ahead. I bought something pretty cool today, Sam. I know you're
what?
Jesus.
Made me look right at her again. I got that the Twin Peaks original score LP.
Oh, that looked so nice.
Mondo Deathwaltz could not get this beautiful piece of vinyl.
Yeah, isn't it the
Damn Fine Coffee Brown? It's amazing.
That's funny. I also have finally ventured into the realm of a person who not only has vinyl, but a person that can play vinyl. I got a record player.
What?
I know.
I feel like you've been talking about getting a record player for a very long time.
I joined the 1900s.
Welcome to the club, first of all. Very excited for you.
Yeah.
Have you got anything cool with this record player?
I have been kind of combing the thrift shops, finding some cool, eclectic old stuff. But I'm really excited. I got the Cannibal Holocaust soundtrack from also Mondo.
Oh, wow.
And have you heard the theme from Cannibal Holocaust,
you
Byron?
Know, I don't know how does that go? Oh, that one. Yeah, I'm familiar with that.
Yeah, well, it's a very, very cool disc. Awesome artwork. It's got a 12x12 poster, and the disc itself is this awesome green and red splatter. Really cool. It's a fun soundtrack. I really am enjoying experiencing physical medium.
It's going to be an expensive couple months, years?
No, I'm going to pace myself with this one.
Kelly doesn't care one bit about
not
physical
not even
medium.
A little.
I'm very excited about the resurgence of horror vinyl. It seems like every soundtrack is getting a vinyl release.
Yeah, Mondo and Death Waltz and Waxwork.
Waxwork is
doing
great.
Some great
I
job.
Mean, Stranger Things had a good soundtrack.
They did release their soundtrack, but not on vinyl.
Oh.
So what?
Digital and CD.
Why would you buy that on a CD?
What about a cassette?
You know, cassette would make more sense, but I mean, in reality, less sense, but in the hip sense, yeah. I don't know. Maybe in 10 years, CDs will be cool. Kelly, what's cool?
Abductions.
Okay, we'll get there. Did you watch anything cool this week?
I actually did.
Really?
Yeah, so while Sam was working the midway, I decided to watch a horror movie. So I was going through to see what was on HBO Go.
I was an honorary carny.
Mm. And I was like, huh, Astronaut's Wife. I always hear a lot about this one. I should watch this one. And I shouldn't have watched it because it was all about pregnant alien babies.
It's weird. Whenever I hear The Astronaut's Wife, I don't picture a horror film at all.
It is. It's very scary. It's very, very scary.
You seem very startled.
And it's also very interesting. So super sexualized movie. And I've always really thought Johnny Depp was like the bee's knees.
Oh, the Depp's in it.
And even though this movie was half sexy time, Johnny Depp really, like, maybe he just got better with age or something, because this was from a while ago and he was just pretty annoying.
Okay.
People His character might, was, at least.
People might argue that he's always been annoying.
Oh, no. He's great now.
You mean Willy Wonka isn't annoying?
I would say that
Hunter S. Thompson, not annoying.
No.
Captain Jack Sparrow, not annoying.
Love.
That's the definition of an annoying man.
Not if you love the Pirates. Anyhow, it was a really good movie. I mean,
Pirates.
Charlize Theron was not very good in it.
So this is a bad movie.
No, no, no.
Is
listen to me. Listen at? To me. Listen to me.
I am.
She was not very good. The tone of the movie, like, she was fine.
Okay.
He was just not up to his awesome depth standards. But again, it was just fine. And the story was really cool.
What's the story of the astronaut's wife?
Two astronauts.
Sure.
Up in space. Outside the space station, doing a spacewalk, fixing something. All of a sudden, all radio communication goes dead for 2 minutes. Just 2 minutes. And then when it comes back on, they get back in the ship and they bring them home. And they've got all these weird medical things. And then they come out of it. But both of them are different. There's something strange that's happened.
I guess I could play the real music.
Both of their wives get pregnant with twins, and then it gets creepy.
Huh. Well, it looks like the soundtrack is by George Clinton.
I don't think it's the
you know, it
George
looks like
Quinn.
George S. Clinton.
I was gonna
I feel
say.
Like it would be helpful for him to change his name.
Is this a funky soundtrack or...
No.
All right.
No.
So you do recommend this movie, though.
Yeah, just try to ignore Johnny Depp's real bad Southern accent.
I'll just ignore him always because...
But the movie's good.
Kind of a
strongly recommend it.
Bad actor.
Oh, I think he's a great actor.
I don't know. I was listening to something about his pay versus how much he makes for a movie.
Yeah.
He makes like $1.2 per dollar that he gets paid.
Wow, that's not a very good return.
No, terrible.
I guess it depends on scale, right? So like if his movies are making $200 million, that still means somebody's making $40 million off of it. That ain't so bad.
I don't know. And he does, I mean, I don't want to get into it, but he did hit his wife quite a bit recently.
That seems to be pretty controversial. There seem to be some very interesting things. I think they might both be just nugging futs. If it turns out that he really did hit her, absolutely.
Okay.
He's a fucking jerk if he actually did. But I'm just debating whether he actually did because they both seemed pretty
sure,
crazy.
Sure. I mean, it seemed like a volatile relationship that needed to end. I just haven't seen a good Johnny Depp in a long time.
I haven't seen a bad Johnny Depp
in
a long time.
Alice in Wonderland.
Liked it.
Rango?
Oh, Rango was great.
Rango
was actually good?
Freaking
yeah.
Fabulous.
Okay, so that's I need to watch it.
Yeah, he plays a lizard.
The Rum Diary?
Love it.
Was it good?
Yes.
Dark Shadows? It was kind of a flop,
It didn't make bank, but it was a fun movie.
The Lone Ranger?
Loved it.
Not good.
Tusk?
Please.
Yeah, okay. I know that was your
marvelous
performance of the year. That's a good song.
Please.
And I mean, I guess I did like Black Mass. Maybe he's fine.
I think he's great.
All right. Did you watch anything else this week?
I did. I watched the first half of Stargate. Don't watch it. It sucks.
What? I've had to have watched Stargate at some point.
The cool thing is, watch the first part of it. I take it back. Watch the first part because it coincides directly with this month's Captain Kelly's episode.
Sure. Okay.
One of the characters played by James Spader seems to be a direct interpretation of one of the anthropologist Egyptologists that I talk about in the episode.
Oh, and Scott.
So that was kind of cool because they talk about the same stuff.
You can't deny a film with a character named Lieutenant Ferretti, played by French Stewart. Is a real talent, you know.
No good.
Spader's
and
good.
He's on the up.
Kurt Russell. I wonder if French Stewart is on the up. So you watched the first half and bailed.
Yeah.
Sam, you seem like a Stargate guy.
I don't know how to take that.
All right. I don't know. It seemed like you
as an insult. That's kind of like being called a carny, I think.
No, you like Kurt Russell and you, I think, were into mid-90s sci-fi.
I will watch anything with Kurt Russell in it. I remember liking this movie when it came out and I haven't seen it since then. The bit of it that I watched last night with Kelly makes me think I should not go back and revisit it.
Right. The director of that movie went on to produce Independence Day, The Day After Tomorrow, Godzilla 1998, and 2012.
Hmm.
Quite a roster.
Loves those big disaster films.
Disasters of films.
Is that a burn?
Yeah.
It's a bit of a burn.
Yeah.
Sam, what did you watch?
Well, in the spirit of this week's Kelly's Cryptids and Conspiracies, I tried to watch an alien movie called Unaware.
Unaware. I'm unaware of that movie.
You should remain so.
Double burn.
Oh, God.
We're doing great.
Unaware.
Oh, my God.
This movie was terrible. I don't know what I was thinking. It's found footage. It's about this couple who goes to the boyfriend's grandfather's ranch in Texas while the grandfather's gone out in the hill country. I'm going to spoil this. The movie ruined itself. I'm not ruining anything by telling what happened. Like, nothing happens for a long time. They're just filming these really inane conversations that are totally unrealistic. And then they end up, for some reason, underneath the barn in a cellar. turns out that the grandfather was stationed at Roswell in the 50s, and he absconded with some, you know, important type things from Roswell. And then the FBI, played by some terrible actor, shows up, and they're trying to cover things up, and it's a running chase, and it's terrible. It's awful.
Uninteresting.
It is not good at all. Don't recommend it. Stay away from Unaware. But like I said, Kelly's into this stuff, so I thought, hey.
I appreciate the gesture.
Where were you streaming that?
That was on Amazon.
I was trying to find something on Amazon to watch this week. There's a lot of bad in there. And I know that there's some gold buried.
But tons of bad.
Then everything's between 3 and 4 star rated. And then you see like some good stuff from this year that's rated 3, you know, and you're like,
or even 2.
How can I judge this? There's no way for me to figure out what's actually good.
I have to IMDb everything that I pick on Amazon before I watch it. Fortunately, I don't know about fortunately. That shows how bad Unaware was that I'm saying fortunately.
Uh-oh.
I watched another movie called They're Watching, which was a 2016 movie.
They're Watching, a film I talked about 2 weeks ago.
Did you watch it?
Yes. You sneer so much during this show. It's fun.
So, Byron, I totally agree with what you had said about this movie. The CG was remarkably terrible.
It's just the third act. I don't know what happened.
The directors were, and I could be covering ground we've already trod, but the directors earned their stripes working for Nickelodeon on projects such as SpongeBob SquarePants.
I did not know that.
Angry Beavers.
I mean, that's a fine series.
Yeah. Angry Beavers was pretty cool. I'm going to defend that.
Relative to Unaware, they're watching.
The first hour of that movie is totally fine.
Yes, I agree. It's fine.
Well-executed found footage that does nothing offensive or
egregiously smack you in the face.
I don't know. Like I said in my review, they didn't really set out to make something great. They like did what they wanted to do. It was bad.
I honestly don't remember CG that bad. I watch a lot of bad movies.
But that has to be purposeful at that point.
Had to be. Yeah. It was too bad to be not deliberate.
Would you recommend anyone else check that out?
Nope.
All right. That's kind of what I figured. Guys, I watched something that I've been meaning to watch for a very long time.
The Haunting?
No, absolutely not The Haunting. A 2002 movie directed by Neil Marshall. You may know as the director of The Descent and some of the best episodes of Game of Thrones.
Stupid werewolves.
Dog Soldiers. What have I been doing with my life before this movie?
I don't know.
Wasting my time. That's it. War gamers get more than they ask for when they stumble upon a pile of viscera mid-game. It's their enemy. What could have done this? Kelly, you spoiled it. It is werewolves.
Sorry.
An enemy.
Is that a spoiler? Is there anybody that doesn't know that that's
know.
What
I mean,
Dog Soldiers is
I guess
about?
Kind of. They've got this new enemy. Everyone's against the werewolves.
Yes.
It's listed as a comedy.
I think so.
It's funny and it's brutal. So two things that, I mean, sometimes don't work together. But in this case, it reminded me of pretty much everything good about the mid-2000s horror. Post-torture porn.
Yeah.
This reminded me a lot of, did you ever see Feast?
Yes.
Yeah, it's maybe like From Dusk Till Dawn.
Because it definitely turns into a siege.
I love a siege. You could siege me all day. Night of the Living Dead, the original siege.
Is it?
I know you don't feel this way, Byron, but I love it when the military's involved in things.
It's interesting. The third act of 28 Days Later where the military gets involved, that did kind of turn me off in that movie. But in this, it kind of starts out there, and I don't know why I didn't have a problem at all. And similar to 28 Days Later, it had that same choppy frame rate camera work. I don't know if that's just a British UK thing.
And the super vivid, over really saturated colors.
Dark, grainy. It must be a British UK thing. I freaking love this movie.
I'm so glad to hear that because honestly, Dog Soldiers is one of my very favorites of all time.
It is. That's true.
I mean, there's no good transformation scene in this werewolf movie, which I think is a key element in that genre.
I totally agree, but I think that's the right choice because he didn't have a budget to do a transformation well.
And also my other problem, which I was talking to you before the show, not much blood as a result of all the gunfire that they were laying on these lycanthropes. But yeah, costumes. There's no way they could soak all these costumes in blood repeatedly. So
all practical effects.
Yeah, it was great. I don't know what I've been doing. I don't even deserve this podcast. I think I need to quit.
Oh, come on.
I think I quit. I quit, guys.
You should quit because you haven't watched The Haunting, not because you haven't watched Dog Soldiers.
I know. Just quit talking about Dog Soldiers, which I highly recommend. I've had it on DVD for so long. I don't know what I was thinking.
So just fun cryptid side note for a second,
oh,
guys.
Oh, yeah. I'd love one.
We haven't been watching the Olympics because we don't have cable.
You see that leg break last week?
Oh, it was ugly.
Oh, yeah. Of course we saw that.
Oh, a little saw that.
Normally, Kelly shows me crap videos.
You pulled up the leg
like
break for
puppy
Sam?
Videos and things like that. And then she comes out with the leg break. And I was like, sweetie, this is, I love you.
Apparently, the golf course at the Olympics has been overrun with world's largest rodents. Do you guys remember a while ago we talked about capybaras? They were thought for a while to be cryptids, and then they discovered they weren't cryptids. They're literally like giant rodents. They get up to 150 pounds.
Yeah, just a big rat.
And they've just taken over the golf course.
Oh, no.
Isn't that great?
Tickled.
That's, I mean, it's kind of fun,
they're,
but
they're pseudo cryptids.
They're not doing well already over there.
Did you hear that this is maybe for another time, but the pool turned green too, which I thought had all sorts of really cool.
What makes it turn green?
They think it's like a wrong ratio of chemicals or something, but it's like green, green, green. Green,
what if they put
green.
In that chemical that when you pee in the pool, it spreads?
That's awesome.
And one of the divers just couldn't wait.
So I immediately thought of The Host.
Oh, man.
Oh, yeah.
Such a fun movie.
Yeah. Anyway. That's
enough about all that.
The cryptid side of the Olympics.
Are we talking about the legs still? Or
no more legs.
That was a flappy leg.
Well, actually, we can talk about a leg, but it's a different leg.
It was an excellent example of someone in shock also.
Yeah, because he didn't scream or anything. He was just like,
he seemed irate.
Honestly, he could have been experiencing that much pain and still irate, though. Those people train so goddamn long. Ugh.
You know, I can't really think of a good segue out of this. Kelly, this is an important topic for you.
Super important.
And I know that we're just going to scratch the surface in the next two episodes, but
the touchstone cases, right? Like
the ones you need to know.
And then at some point later, we'll go down the tunnel a bit with it. But for right now,
this is Alien Abductions Part 1.
You bet, you bet, you bet, you bet, you bet.
And Kelly's Cryptids and Conspiracies.
Kelly's Cryptids and Conspiracies.
Not to me, you son of a bitch. I see right through your seeming.
The mic's on.
Sorry. So everybody knows what alien abductions are, but I'm going to give a rundown real quick anyway, just because it's kind of fun.
Did you know it's only like 535 people have been in space, technically?
That we acknowledge.
And actually maybe not that many, because some of them maybe haven't been in space.
Oh my gosh.
All sorts of moving numbers there. So abductions are kind of a blanket term, and they describe all sorts of different things that could be happening. I want to really assert that at the front end. They are often called alien abductions, and I will probably call them that throughout these two episodes because that's what people describe them as. I am not going to say that that is the only possible explanation for what's going on. Whatever range of claims might exist for what is going on behind the scenes, there is an undeniable large number of people who report being captured, communicated with, toured with, returned, and feeling aftermath symptoms of abduction by what they believe to be extraterrestrial beings. Though I'm not going to say that I think I've been abducted, I do have ridiculously vivid memories my entire childhood for like 5 years. My bedroom was on the second floor, and I would seriously have the same dream every night of a giant gray alien face at my window. And then I do have this really weird scar on the back of my leg.
I mean, are we going to post a picture of the scar finally in the show notes of this episode at Frightday.com?
No.
Because it doesn't exist?
No, it does.
You just seem like, that see, seems like something.
There? It's there?
I don't know. I don't see it.
Bullshit, you don't. All right, I'll put a picture up. So it is kind of a freaky concept for me. Believe it or not, this is one of those where investigating it a little more deeply has been rather
therapeutic.
Yeah, I was trying to come up with a smart word, but my smart word brain isn't working.
It's kind of late.
Yeah, it's actually helped me. I'm slightly less terrified, but many abductions are described in conjunction with grays, the short, skinny guys with the pear-shaped heads and the
cold, spindly fingers.
Yep, spindly fingers,
God,
big black eyes.
Fingers.
I hate spindly fingers. Reports come from all around the world. Most of what we're going to talk about tonight is definitely United States-based, but just keep in mind that this is by no means an American-centric experience. Obviously, the ones that I'm going to be able to read the most about happen to be in English.
I feel like it's the majority, though, right?
No, actually not necessarily. There's a ton in Russia, in South America, in Europe, actually quite a few. just something to keep in mind. Maybe at some point we'll even do a specifically international abduction episode. That'd be kind of fun, yeah. Because there are lots of really, really good ones out there. In fact, one of the most famous cases is an Argentinian, no, a Brazilian guy that was abducted in the 50s. That's like one of the most famous cases. But we aren't going to cover that. The first alien abduction incident that we're going to talk about tonight is probably one many people haven't heard about, but it's very interesting because it is arguably the only case that produced DNA potential evidence of alien abductions. It's going to seem pretty weird. I want you guys to keep in mind, an open mind is the best mind.
Or cover that mind up with a tinfoil hat, maybe.
Just make sure it's open when you put the hat on. A gentleman named Peter Corey was born in Lebanon, moved to Australia in the 70s, met his future wife, had two kids. A lot of this has been actually tracked by an Australian UFO researcher. And this, I suppose, we are starting on an international case. So he and seven other children, when he was 7 years old, had gone up to the flat rooftop of his neighbor's house to play. He was the last to walk through a heavy door that leads onto the roof, and he saw all of his friends frozen like statues in front of him, while a, quote, silent egg-shaped craft hovered above. All eight children later found themselves on the ground floor after some time had passed with no memory of what happened in between. So this is a group abduction incident.
Eight people.
One of them being Peter. Yep. In February of 1988, Peter and his wife, you know, flash forward 17 years, he and his wife see some weird movement in the sky, producing strange lights and some kind of a light beam. It suddenly jogs something in his memory. About 6 months later, he's kind of been toying with these memories in the back of his head and trying to figure out what it was that happened, because that really tickled something that he's like, this seems familiar to me. July of that same year, he was laying on bed, suddenly couldn't move, saw a number of beings around him. One of them, a tall, thin, golden yellow colored being with large black eyes, inserted a long needle-like object into the side of his head.
Ugh.
Yeah.
If there's one thing I like less than a long needle, it's a needle-like object.
Right, because you don't actually know what it is.
Because a needle has implications of purification and being made of surgical steel.
Yeah, depending on
the
scenario.
Needle-like object, that could be a long branch.
I'm not into it.
Well,
a stick.
We got to trust the technology with these guys. They're pretty far advanced, obviously. So, but I suppose they also may not give a shit about us. We don't use our best needles on rats, I would imagine.
Oh,
so
sad.
People are jerks. All right, moving right along. Corey blacks out, wakes up, rushes into the room by his bedroom where he finds his other family members kind of like a zombie state. He manages to wake them up and finds out that all of them think that maybe 10 minutes have passed, but really it's been about 2 hours. He has some kind of an injury to his head. So at this time he has no real idea what's going on. He becomes aware that alien abduction experiences are happening. Initially enters the UFO field to start studying them and understand what might have happened to him, becomes really frustrated with the politics and issues that plague him being associated with ufology. So he formed a support group, which was, we're talking pre-X-Files days.
Sure.
Right? So keep in mind, as crazy as I might seem, this stuff has become pretty mainstream these days. It used to be like real cuckoo to talk about any of it. He's trying to really focus on helping other people out, but is continually bugged by really not being entirely sure what happened to him. On July 23rd of 1992, here's the big one, and this is the one you want to hear about, Byron.
What, why?
He's been kind of sick. He's chilling in bed about 7 a.m. He's in his Sydney suburban home, just got back from the train station, dropped off his wife. Like I said, not feeling well. So he lays down, goes to sleep, wakes up, and there's something by the bed, and he sees that this something happens to be two strange women kneeling on the end of his bed. Both were naked.
Uh-huh.
One appeared Nordic and the other Asian.
Ooh.
Aspects of their appearance were quite odd. Here we go. The Nordic female had a very elongated face and a sharply pointed chin. Her eyes appeared to be blue and 2 to 3 times larger than normal. Kind of Farrah Fawcett-y hair that was like really wispy and blown up all over the place.
Kind of reminds me of, in my head, what Roger from American Dad looks like when he wears a wig.
Absolutely.
Okay,
just
that works.
Not attractive.
But with big honkers.
And her skin color wasn't just light. It was like lighter than any skin color he'd seen before. It was like weird light. The Asian looked basically to have almost completely black eyes. Hair was black and it was kind of like glued almost like a doll into this kind of bob cut.
Oh, man.
But it was not moving. Okay.
So, and I'll have an artist impression of these two aliens up in the show notes at Frightday.com.
Real interesting pictures. Family warning, don't show these to your children.
I'll put censor bars.
Okay. Yeah. You should put Kelly's logo over them.
That's not how.
Okay. No. Well, whatever.
Absolutely not.
So there's no normal communication that's occurring. You hear this a lot in abduction stories, but the Nordic woman seems to be in charge and he can sense that. She's kind of showing the Asian woman the ropes. That seems to be what's going on.
I don't like any of this.
I know you don't. The Nordic woman, according to him, seems to be more than 6 feet tall, pretty darn strong, basically yanks his head into her boob. And he's like, what are you doing? He like tries to pull away. She does this three times.
He did not try to pull away.
This is his
report. I swear, dude, I freaking swear I did.
So,
honey, I tried so hard. It was just,
Sam,
the boob was just right there.
She tried three times. And finally, this part's going to really lose you guys. Okay. She tried three times.
This part is?
His head's buried in there.
Just motorboating.
Well, and keep in mind at this point, like he's free. He knows that this is something similar to what's happened to him before in terms of alien stuff, right? These two people are very obviously not normal women. They've got these giant eyes. They're weird colored.
I mean, it's as if it's something you'd see in a fever dream.
Right. Well, check this out, though. This is what proves it wasn't. He bit her nipple off.
All right.
A part of it.
Thanks for hanging out. Where can we find you on the internet?
And accidentally swallows it. And starts coughing. He says it was really strange. There wasn't any sign of blood. It was very obvious that this was just some kind of like a weird shell.
He determined by biting off the nipple.
He describes her look and the interaction between she and the other woman as this Nordic woman seems to be looking at the other one like, this isn't how it's supposed to work. This isn't what's supposed to happen.
They're training, and she's like, "No, listen.
This isn't normal. Don't worry. You won't experience this most of the time." So
I'm just training you because I felt like it was the right thing to do. Today's my last day.
We don't all get treated like ice cream cones.
So, but it was very like she wasn't experiencing any pain from it. She was just like, "What the fuck are you doing? Like, what the hell?" But he's coughing his brains out and then looks up and they're gone. So he goes into the bathroom. He's like choking on this.
Uh-huh.
Okay.
On his nipples.
Single piece. Okay.
Piece of nipple.
Yep.
How big were these nipples that he couldn't get it all with one bite?
Well, you can take a peek at those nipples uncensored in the show notes of this episode of Friday.com.
There is no picture
can
of the nipples.
And should.
Can we stop? Right, can we stop?
Absolutely.
Okay. He's coughing, goes to the bathroom, gets a drink of water, goes to the bathroom, and realizes that there is some very fine blonde hair wrapped really tightly around him.
Around what part of him?
I don't like being pornographic.
No, I mean, listen, this is his story, his words. You're talking about his penis.
Yes.
Okay. Blonde hair wrapped around his penis.
He's like, something really weird's going on here. I'm going to actually save this hair. Seems like a good idea. And it wasn't just blonde hair. It was like
white hair.
Clear, even. It was like super weird looking hair. Nothing like he'd ever seen. He's really freaked out about telling his wife for obvious reasons. Finally, he tells her, and she totally believes what's happening to him at this point. And so she's really nice. She's like, there's nothing you can do about this. We'll do with this the best we can. So he has quite a few more experiences, but this is the big deal because this has some evidence, right? So in 1998, there's this Australian author and UFO researcher named Bill Chalker. He decides he's going to help get this hair sample evaluated. So he has biochemical colleagues who agree to undertake what was the world's first polymerase chain reaction DNA profiling of biological material implicated in an alien abduction experience. Here's what they found. The analysis confirmed that the hair came from someone who was biologically close to normal human genetics, but of a very, very unusual race type. It was a rare mix of Chinese and something else, but definitely should not have had white hair, like unquestionably.
Okay, sure. Okay.
Apparently, the DNA sequencing lies further from the human primary sequencing than any other race except for African pygmies and aboriginals. So an artist's impression of the blonde-haired Nordic, you guys have that, kind of shows why this person doesn't really look like they should be a Chinese descendant, but who knows?
The white-haired Nordic.
Yeah, that's the one who's
not
whose
the
hair.
One that does look as if.
Right, right. No, because this is the white hair. This is the white hair. There was a strange anomaly, first of all, that it was blonde to clear instead of black, which it should have been. And the conclusion of the study was the most probable donor of the hair must therefore be, as Corey claims, a tall blonde female who does not need much color in her hair or skin as a form of protection against the sun, or perhaps because she doesn't require it.
Is it possible that this is an albino Asian? Which could be my favorite thing I've Googled all day.
Okay, well, that isn't directly addressed in the literature that I read. However, there are two types of DNA that were found on the hair, depending on where it was tested. So close to the roots was one piece, and close to, you know, further down was a different piece. So further down in the normal chunk of hair is where this Chinese DNA comes in. But close to the root, guess what the DNA was?
I don't know. What was
Basque.
It?
Basque.
What?
Yep.
Of the Basque people?
All roads
people?
Lead to the Basque.
Oh. I'm telling you. It's all about the Basques. Yeah. We need to get a Basque collar someday.
Explain to them what Basque is.
It's a region in, I think mostly in Spain. If you have Rh negative blood, the idea is that it all kind of traces back to that as an origin point. And there are lots of pretty crazy left field theories about what Rh negative and Basque ancestry could mean. Pretty far out there.
Check out more about Rh negative blood in episode 63 of this podcast.
Sure can.
You go into detail about
it. I do.
It. I do. Obnoxious amounts.
Well, a little bit. Yeah. Right. But it's kind of, there's not a lot of info out there until you get pretty deep. But some of it is, I mean, real far out there, all just right. To warn you.
Basque hair.
Yeah. So it's like part Basque, part Chinese. And this is pretty weird because it's basically grafted DNA. This was super controversial until a Nature biotechnology paper in 2000 revealed recent findings on hair transplanting with previously incompatible hair using advanced cloning techniques developed as a possible cure for baldness. It seemed to be something similar to this, but it was way earlier. It was 8 years before that. There also appeared in the DNA strain to be some type of viral resistance. Now, obviously, I know nothing about genetics, but the way that they describe it is, quote, the hair sample seems to show it contains two deleted genes for CCR5 protein and no intact gene for the normal undeleted CCR5. This CCR5 deletion factor has been implicated in AIDS resistance. So kind of interesting. Again, this possible connection to the Basques. There were lots of Nordic looking legends of gods and goddesses in the Basque mythology. Yeah, so the one issue that I think it's really cool that we've got this DNA evidence. Clearly, I'm hoping that they do further testing, because the testing that was available in 1999, I mean, by this point, oh my God, they could do a whole lot more with it. I haven't been able to find a lot. There are lots of recent stories, but no recent stories about recent research. So I'm hoping that they will be able to do some more. The issue I have is I couldn't find the actual scientific report anywhere, just the interpretation of it by Bill Chalker, who's this Australian researcher. But he walks through it in great detail, and he seems to be, you know, thorough. But I think it would be far more beneficial to have the actual scientific paper published so that people who know what they're talking about, which in terms of genetic research, certainly not me, but somebody could read it and evaluate whether this really seemed legit or not. It worries me when people distance the public one generation from that actual source material. That always worries me.
So this Peter Corey guy,
mm-hmm.
You believe that he was abducted at an early age and this was just like a home check-in, an old school doctor?
A lot of abduction stories take place over a number of years. So a lot of times when you hear kids being visited, it happens throughout their lives. Then sometimes they're isolated incidents, but more often than not, there's a series and a pattern to them. It's almost as though they're tracking progression in some way. Of a human being through life. They could just be making like all their own little versions of boy. Who knows?
Boy, they're yeah. Popping in every few years.
Could be. Could be.
Richard Linklater of the sky.
Yeah. All yeah. Right. So that's the Peter Corey story.
After this last visit, was he visited again?
Yeah. It seemed to never stop for him.
Is he dead?
I don't think so. No, I think he's still kicking it.
Oh, good.
Yeah, good for him. So the next one that we're going to talk about, you guys, I'm sure have heard of. We've actually talked about it briefly on the podcast before.
Years ago.
Betty and Barney Hill, total trailblazers in the field of alien abduction experience.
And in racial equality.
Yeah, I mean, they were seriously making it easier for those of us who came after in a lot of different categories. Just for frame of reference, Betty had a master's degree in social work. Barney served as the governor of New Hampshire's Civil Rights Commission. Both of them had a lot of respect from the people who knew them, other than racist assholes who didn't think they should be married.
Yeah, they're an interracial couple.
Yeah. One of the important things to remember with this story is they really had nothing to gain by coming forward. They lost a ton by coming forward with their story. Barney was very resistant to coming out about what had happened to them because he knew people would be crazy about it. they lost a lot of respect from a lot of their peers because of this story. So it wasn't as though they were getting fame and fortune for it. You know, I think people will sometimes use that as a reason that people might lie about it. And one of the things that is common to all the stories that I'm going to talk about tonight and next week, I will go very far to say none of these people are lying. Some of them may be recalling information that's different from the reality that happened, but I firmly believe that every single one of these people believes in their core that this is what happened to them. I think it's a really easy skeptic point to say, oh, they're just trying to get their 15 minutes of fame. They just want money from it, blah, blah, blah. And almost never does that happen. Case after case after case. You look at like Whitley Strieber, who we'll talk about next week. He was making bank as an author, and he has made far less on the books that he made based on his UFO experiences. He was ridiculed. He's had death threats his entire life since that point.
I mean, he was actually, before I knew, this is funny. Well, we'll talk about Whitley next week.
Yeah, well, you look at even Travis Walton, who we'll talk about next week too. He's the Fire in the Sky guy. He actually lost tons of money because of it. People think, oh, they made a movie out of him. He got like nothing for that. He lost tons of money, and he continues to talk about this. Most of the time charges nothing for the speeches that he goes and gives and does presentations. Very few people make money off of coming out about UFO and abduction stories. It makes their lives more difficult, not better.
1961.
This lovely married couple who, as I said, lots of respect from people around them. They were driving home from a quick vacation at Niagara Falls when they saw what they thought was a falling star. But it was jumping all over the sky and it was getting bigger. They decided they were going to go real slow along the road and see if they can follow it as it got closer to them. Yeah, it's kind of cool, right? Eventually, they stop in the middle of the highway as the object hovers only like 80 to 100 feet from them. So they're pretty freaked out. Barney is so freaked out that he gets out of the car with binoculars to get a closer look. He claims that he saw a craft with 8 to 10 humanoid creatures in black uniforms in it. He screamed, "They're going to capture us," and ran back to the car, and the couple drove home. A trip that should have taken 3 hours mysteriously took 7. They couldn't account for the missing time, so basically 4 hours. A ton of other strange things happened, which led them to conclude eventually that they had been abducted. So here's what happens. They arrive at home around dawn. They had some weird sensations or impulses they couldn't really explain. Betty didn't really want to bring their luggage into the house. She felt like it should be kept near the back door instead because she thinks there's something weird about it now. Their watches that they wore that night never worked again.
Did they stop at a specific time?
They did not stop at. They both stopped at different times by the accounts that I've read, but they never ever worked again.
Interesting.
The leather strap on Barney's binoculars was torn, though he doesn't remember tearing it at all when he got back in the car, like it was perfectly intact. The toes of his best dress shoes, which he had worn on his lovely trip with his wife, were scraped to hell. Again, he doesn't remember that happening. They started trying to reconstruct the chronology of what happened that night, and immediately after they heard the buzzing sounds, their memories became incomplete and fragmented.
Buzzing sounds?
Yeah, so they're able to remember that they see this UFO and they hear kind of a weird buzzing sound afterwards. And that's kind of the last memory that either of them can pull out. Both of them vaguely recalled some kind of a moon shape that they describe as sitting on the road. And then Barney has a memory of saying, "Oh no, not again."
Oh.
Yeah. So, and it could just be that they were trying to get away from this thing and they kept seeing it over and over again. They slept for a few hours and then Betty woke up, put the shoes and clothing she'd worn during the drive in her closet, noticed that the dress was torn at the hem, the zipper, and the lining. There was also this weird pinkish powder that when she dusted it off, it had left a pink stain. It was basically irreparably damaged. She wasn't able to use it ever again.
Which was really the worst thing that happened to them.
Oh, come on.
That dress.
You know what this reminds me of? This reminds me of that damn Coke commercial at the movie theater.
Oh.
Where,
Did I really ruin your dress?
Yeah. No. Slamming a dress in a car door does not ruin it. Alien abduction.
I hope everyone gets the same Coke commercial at the movies.
I know. I hope it's not regional.
That's way too expensive to be regional.
It really makes me want violence in the movie that I watch after that commercial.
Hey, Kelly, is there any chance that this was some sort of MKUltra-esque Quaalude experiment?
I'm going to say press pause on that, Byron, because we're going to talk about that next week.
All right.
Yeah. Next week, we're going to do a couple more stories, and then I'm going to talk about what theories I have about what could be going on and what theories other people have too. Over the years, 5 different laboratories have conducted chemical and forensic analysis on the dress. Nobody's found anything particularly extraterrestrial about it. what, but there are some weird stains on it that they can't seem to explain. No smoking gun there. There were also shiny concentric circles on their car trunk that had not been there the previous day. They kind of messed around with the compass and noted that when they moved it close to the spots, the needle would spin around like crazy. But as soon as they moved it a few inches away, it would simmer down again. So weeks and days after this, they're having continued anxiety about what happened, which I would too if I didn't remember what the hell happened for 4 hours and Sam didn't either. That would freak me out.
There were some years. Never mind.
It was never simultaneous. Anyhow, the point is, they decided to seek further for answers of what really might have happened. Betty was really at the forefront of this investigation. Barney was very hesitant. Like I said, he really didn't want to be public about this at all. Betty started doing some research and decided that if they had really seen something that was extraterrestrial, they could have been exposed to some form of radioactivity or cosmic rays. Because at this point in time, there's...
Hey, what's a cosmic ray?
It's something from the 50s.
Yeah, okay. Something definitely
good.
From the 50s. Apparently from the 60s, too. But that's where, you know, that's where her fear went immediately. They had this weird feeling they couldn't get whatever dirt or grime on them. They couldn't get it off. They, like, kept taking showers over and over again, like, almost obsessive compulsively, and couldn't feel like everything was gone. Kind of creeped them out. There was an official investigation by Project Blue Book. You all remember Project Blue Book. So Major Paul W. Henderson.
Favorite project.
Yeah, he talked to the Hills by telephone a few hours after their encounter, but it took them 2 years to produce a final report on their sighting. On the 27th of September, 1963, the report claimed that there was insufficient evidence to determine what caused their sighting, and it guesses that they probably saw Jupiter or something similar.
It sounds like they got kind of brushed off a bit there.
Of course they did. That's just what happened, right?
I feel bad that Betty put Barney through all of this.
Well, I mean, here's...
It's 1961. He's just trying not to
get murdered, right?
It's awful.
It's horrible. Their life was pretty damn difficult because they were very outspoken with the civil rights movement. Like, they were not just being passive. They were in a very scary position.
You know
very, very
how
scary
everyone
position.
Wants to kill us already?
Okay. You know what, though? She's all about the truth. And bravo to that woman. I would do the same thing to you, Samwell.
Thanks.
Sorry.
I guess.
Is this one of the cases where they had more experiences?
No, not really. Here are some interesting things that happen, though. Betty starts doing more and more research. And they kind of start to decide that maybe they really had been abducted. Betty starts having a series of nightmares, dreams that alien men took them to a landed craft in the nearby woods, conducted medical examinations on them before returning them to their car. These dreams outlined what they later recalled when they went through hypnotic regression. Betty kind of thought these dreams might have been memories of real events, but Barney thought, no way, they're just vivid dreams. And I think a lot of, at least what I understood about the experience for Barney is he's just trying to bury it. He may have actually believed that they were real, but he's just telling Betty, let's just forget about it. I'm sure they're just dreams. Whatever. We're done with this. They had a meeting on the 25th of November, 1961. Two UFO investigators associated with the National Investigations Committee on Aerial Phenomena, a guy named Robert Homan and C.D. Jackson, they interviewed the Hills for 12 hours. This Major James McDonald, who was an Air Force intelligence officer based at Pease, P-E-A-S-E, Air Force Base, also came. Some people like to get into this conspiracy theory where James McDonald was there for sinister purposes, but really he was actually a friend of Barney's, and that's why he was there. So they hung out
just
with
moral support.
Well, yeah, and they were close to this Air Force Base, so they actually had friends who worked at the Air Force Base, so that there wasn't anything shady there, at least that I could find. So during the meeting, they're talking about their missing time. Obviously, the investigators say, oh, there's time that we can't piece together from what you're telling us. And Betty's like, yeah, no kidding. Obviously. That's what we've been saying. They spoke about the sighting of the humanoids, but not about Betty's dreams.
I mean, who wants to hear a dream?
Well, and I think Barney at this point is saying, like, can we please? And she's probably, you know, she's like, okay, well, let's have this compromise. Let's have this interview, but I promise not to go into my crazy dreams. So they're worried about this idea that maybe they had hallucinated the whole experience. Major McDonald actually suggests to them, maybe you guys should go through hypnosis to try and get to the root of the matter so that you two can chill out, because this is obviously something that's bothering you both a lot. And that might be one of the only ways you can get some actual answers. He didn't have an actual hypnotherapist that he could recommend at this point, so it was kind of just left there for a while. Barney had some health problems thereafter, but in the first half of 1964, There was a Boston psychiatrist and neurologist by the name of Dr. Benjamin Simon. He did this hypnotic regression session series with them and basically through that series fully revealed their abduction experience. Here's what they recalled under hypnosis. And again, it was pretty identical to the nightmares Betty had had. They went down a black road that was blocked by 11 or 12 aliens, each somewhere between 5 and 5.5 feet tall. The humanoids had no ears, but slit-like mouths, small noses, cat-like eyes that seemed to extend to the side of their heads, and broad foreheads that tapered down to a small chin. They were taken to a nearby landed UFO. Inside, they were put in separate rooms, stripped, put on examination tables. The aliens inserted a long needle into Betty's navel. She's told that it's a pregnancy test, and there is a cup placed over Barney's groin. Later, he has this ring of warts exactly where this cup was placed. Some ufologists claim that the aliens used this device to obtain sperm samples from Barney. Betty supposedly spoke to one of the aliens who showed her a star map. And this comes into play later, so remember the star map. She tries taking away a book full of strange writing, but they wouldn't let her take it. When Betty gets back to the car, she sees Barney sitting inside of it, kind of in a daze. So their timing was obviously a little different here. That might have something to do with the watches. I don't know. Under hypnosis, they state very, very similar things. However, there are a couple of differences. For example, Betty talks about talking with them telepathically, whereas Barney says that one of them spoke English to him. There are a couple small differences like that. But generally speaking, the stories are pretty darn similar. Here are some skeptic and believer points. So some people say, okay, the idea of UFOs and abductions can very easily be planted in people's subconscious just by pop culture. Now, at this point in time, actually, alien abductions were very, very rare. There were tons of UFO sightings, but the idea of being taken by the aliens was not a super common thing. This was the weird deal. But the flip side of it is Betty's sister had actually witnessed a UFO about 4 years before this incident happened. So it wasn't as though UFOs were a complete foreign concept to them either. All right. This hypnotization didn't take place until 2 years after the experience. So obviously they did have plenty of time to discuss if they were going to come up with some joint lie. However, all people involved with the case say again that there's no way they're lying. They might be mistaken. They might be misremembering. There might be something else to explain it, but they're really not lying. And there are so many corroborating points from their separate hypnosis sessions that would be really hard to explain. There is Air Force evidence of something actually being seen that night at the Air Force base. Both skeptics and believers use this point in their arguments. So skeptics say, well, the evidence is really light. In the Blue Book file, it's file number 100-1-61. All that it says is, during a casual conversation on September 22nd, 1961, between Major Gardner and B. Reynolds, it was revealed that a strange incident occurred at 2:14 a.m. local on September 20th. That's all that it says in Blue Book. But as we all know about Blue Book, there was a lot of stuff that was cut out of there. And the fact that it's mentioned at all, I think, is kind of a big deal. Because that corroborates that there was something being tracked by radar and that was seen that night.
Not only that, but it's almost counterintuitive, where if there had been nothing, they would have said nothing. There's something that was warranted a comment. They're like, wow, if somebody else saw this, we need to have an excuse ready.
Right.
We need to say what this was.
Right, exactly.
This is in air quotes.
Yeah. So the star map piece that I asked you guys to remember, this is the biggest piece of evidence tied to the Hill case and probably why it's persisted for as long as it has. She drew this star map that she was supposedly shown by the aliens when she went up to the ship. Now, skeptics have argued that it's just vague dots and lines that could be matched with a whole range of stellar
systems.
Yeah, but
some people claim that it actually shows where Luke Skywalker is.
Now, that would be hilarious. I would love that. We are going to put up a picture of her actual drawing. There are lots of interpretations of her drawing, but this is actually her drawing. And we're also going to put up a map of the star system that it turns out to coincide with. What's very interesting is at the time she drew this, we had not yet discovered this star system. It was not within supposedly the realm of human knowledge. Okay. She draws it out. You guys can look at it, decide what you think. The map that she produces, I feel, is pretty uncanny. The similarities are a bit absurd. Real absurd, actually. But I'm interested to hear what you guys think. Pretty interesting case. The star map is really one of the biggest pieces of evidence that we have. Again, I would argue that they stood nothing to gain by coming forward. So I think the only two options we can consider here is that what they're remembering is different from what actually happened because of something else, or what they're remembering truly is what happened. But I don't think that them bullshitting is one of the options on the table. Really don't think so. The last story we're going to talk about tonight involves a gentleman named Jesse Long. Before we can get into him, though, I have to give a brief background about Dr. John Mack, because he's one of the most credible people who's been associated with alien abduction study. He was unfortunately passed away recently, he was an American psychiatrist, a writer. He was a professor at Harvard Medical School, Pulitzer Prize winning author, and became basically the authority on the effects of alien abduction experiences. So he insisted on investigating them purely from his specialty, which is psychiatry. Though he admits that there are lots of implants and pieces out there that might be evidence of alien abductions, he said, those are not for me to evaluate. That's not my field. I'm evaluating from a purely psychiatric standpoint. When he started doing that, it was pretty interesting. Harvard tried to fire him in 1990 when his book Abduction, Human Encounters with Aliens was published. It went to the top of the bestsellers list. He appeared on radio and television programs everywhere. It was the first time in Harvard's history that a tenured professor was subjected to this kind of an investigation. Made headlines that Harvard was doing this to him. They eventually dropped the case and issued a statement that said he has academic freedom to study what he wishes, and he remains a member in good standing of the Harvard Faculty of Medicine. Jesse did work with him in terms of his regression and understanding what had happened to him. He did work with him. I think probably the best thing to do is to give an introduction about Jesse in this little video clip we have. And it's actually part of an ABC special that was aired in 1999, I believe. And what you're going to hear is Whitley Strieber, who you're going to hear a lot more about next week. Whitley Strieber interviewing Jesse Long. So during the regression session that you just heard the horrifying first few seconds of, Jesse recalls that he and his brother were separated and he was placed flat on a table. There was some sort of operation that was performed on his legs. He recalls that an implant was inserted into his left shin. It was in his body for 34 years to follow. Basically, further on in this interview, he talks about how it always caused him a little bit of pain. He had to wear his sock in just the right place so it wouldn't rub against it. Finally, in 1991, he had it removed. Dr. Lear is very famous for removing alien implants. What is that?
It's a big alien implant scar. I used to have this big bump in my leg here.
Okay, what is it actually?
I don't know. I don't remember.
You guys, I have knives. We don't need to wonder about these things.
I'll pop open my gam.
You're not popping anything.
Slap down some plastic and go to work.
Wait until I go to bed.
I can't get the skinny jean rolled down.
Sorry, Byron.
What am I gonna do?
You kids and your skinny jeans.
So they remove this implant. To the naked eye, it kind of looks like a shard of glass, but during initial tests, it snapped into two pieces. And though this was kind of unfortunate, they were able to see a little bit more about what was inside. So it was put through pretty extensive research at the Southwest Research Institute in Texas. And the object, here's a quote from the research report, revealed a very remarkable composition and exhibited unique surface characteristics that cannot be explained. Their final conclusion was the questions outnumbered the answers.
So he biffed it on a bike as a kid and got a rock in his leg?
No, it's definitely not that.
No.
It's absolutely not that. I'm sorry.
What about a snake bite? A fang broke off in there.
No.
Yeah, Sam, what are you, stupid?
Yes.
I'm sorry.
So here's an interesting part of his abduction experience that I'm going to relay to you guys. Again, a lot of the stuff he's remembered through hypnosis. But in 1990, Jesse Long was driving from California to New Orleans, and then right outside of Albuquerque, New Mexico, his car was lifted off the interstate from some force and brought into a craft with him still in the car.
Oh, right.
That's not entirely uncommon, especially because it's the middle of the night and there's nobody around, right? So he was placed on a table and was presented with a baby and was told, this is your child. And it obviously was looking a little different than your normal baby. It had, like, some of those alien eyes.
Okay.
There were 9 other children standing along the wall, and they all looked at Jesse, and he knew right away that they were all his children. Each child walked up to Jesse and touched him on his hand, and as they walked by him, they looked him straight in the eyes. They walked out of the room, and Jesse felt that the message these children were giving him was, we're okay, thank you.
Also, wake up. You're driving.
No, stop it. So, pretty traumatic. I mean, if you found out that you had, like, 9 half-alien kids chilling somewhere.
I'd want to go hang out with them at
you
that
think
point.
So?
That's a lot of kids you're responsible for.
As soon as you show up, then there's the whole child support, and then back child support, and maybe alimony. It's just, believe me, you don't want it.
Well, point is, he is pretty freaked out by this whole thing. He just really wants to know why the hell this is happening to him. Why'd you guys choose me? I'm not really that special.
Is he ugly?
No, just pretty normal looking dude. I mean, you know, he's very 90s looking.
I guess what they're looking for could be completely different than what we find attractive.
Right. And like I said, we're going to do a lot of theories next week about why this might be happening and what actually might be happening. We're going to end today with just a little clip. This is from that same special in 1999. And what you're going to hear is a dialogue with Whitley Strieber talking about this implant. But then you're also going to hear information from the doctors who removed it and what their thoughts are and what the hell this is.
The surgeon makes an incision, and it's time to remove the foreign object. The object is dark, almost black in color.
I think it's fairly safe to say at this point that this object is certainly not similar to any of the usual objects that are removed from the human body. This is one of the most unusual objects that I've seen in 34 years of medical practice.
The first step in analyzing the object was to study its surface. To do that, it was examined through a scanning electron microscope. This allowed for it to be magnified up to 500 times its actual size. The object appeared to be predominantly iron, perhaps a small fragment of a steel knife or tool. But in order to reach a more definitive conclusion, the unknown object had to be analyzed under its surface, on the inside. For that process, it was brought to the University of Texas in San Antonio.
It looks like it might be an iron oxide. If we can crush it and get it to very small size, we'll be able to really get to the internal structure more readily.
The object resisted crushing, but an outside layer did flake off. This was put under X-ray diffraction, and the results of this test were curious. They couldn't match it to any of the 65,000 known substances in their computer file.
It's not in our file. I'm not sure what to think about that at the present time. That's as many known substances that we have on the planet as possible.
According to the lab's official report, if the material analyzed is indeed iron, it lacks any internal ordered arrangement of atoms or ions. Whatever substances make up this unknown sample, it's a mystery this test couldn't solve.
Well, it's exciting. That's a lot of alien abduction groundwork we've covered here.
It is. We're just scratching the surface. Like I said, next week we'll do a couple more, and then at some point in the future we'll dive deeper. But I think it's important that everybody gets a foundation in this really important topic.
I appreciate that report.
Thanks. All right. I appreciate you guys. You were actually pretty damn supportive, fellas.
This is a really great report.
I liked your tude during this report. High five, guys.
That's just keep this pounding up. Headache I have.
Keep this up. There might be another promotion in your future.
I hate you.
Yeah.
You're my least favorite.
Yeah, okay.
Can she be two people's least favorite?
Nope.
So, Kelly, I do have to apologize.
Yeah.
First of all, big exciting announcement. Our Patreon patrons already know this, but you're growing a monster.
A creature.
A creature, yes. Inside of your body.
Fingers crossed for Puckwudgie.
All right. Congratulations.
Thank you.
Sam, good work.
Yeah. Thanks, man. Next one, Sam's carrying.
I apologize. We watched a little movie. A
little bit insensitive of you tonight, Byron.
A bit of a pregnancy horror film called Shelley.
Yeah.
Let's get into it.
Okay.
Hope you're enjoying your visit here this evening. Now, on with the show.
Shelley is a 2016 Danish horror drama written and directed by Ali Abbasi. Sam, could you tell us what this film is about?
An unholy force takes root in an expectant mother's womb in this eerie, dread-inducing shocker. Privileged nouveau eco-hippies Louise and Casper live off the grid in a remote home in the woods. Unable to conceive, the couple arranges for their immigrant maid, Elena, to act as a surrogate mother in exchange for payment. But as Elena becomes mysteriously sicker with each passing day, fears mount about what may be growing inside her.
Boy, do those fears mount.
Yeah.
Screws really turn.
Yeah, I guess I'm glad that all theories point to the baby inside me being mine.
Uh-huh.
I suppose it could be an alien implant, but...
Well, maybe.
But otherwise,
Sam
it's mine.
Credit, a little bit.
Well, it could be Sam plus an alien implant, you know? Who knows?
I don't even want to dissect that statement.
I do want to dissect your thoughts on this film. Sam, what's your general assessment here? What do we got?
I was optimistic going into this movie because pregnancy horror is, it can be a cheap device to
shock.
To shock, exactly. And I like to be shocked.
I do too.
And because you're so sensitive about your wife's current status, right?
Yes, and absolutely.
You're really worried about feeling bad about the baby.
I am. This is true. So I was actually, I had pretty high expectations going into this because the premise sounded interesting to me, you know, like a Rosemary's Baby, Damien type child from The Omen. But I was very pleasantly rewarded, I guess, for my faith in this movie.
Thick atmosphere. Yeah. From the get-go. It does have a bit of a slow burn start.
It takes a while to get going, but I think it's all important groundwork for what comes later.
And you can't deny these beautiful foreign film landscapes.
Yeah, Danish film. They make the best possible use of their location, which is this very cool old house on a lake with no neighbors, as far as we can tell. And some very cool wide shots of the boat in the lake, the forest. Just really beautiful. And as far as feel goes, I would say that this movie, I would compare and compare favorably to Antichrist.
Oh, absolutely.
Definitely Antichrist. Not as intense and insane.
I need to watch that movie again. I feel like something happens to someone in that I think it shaped me.
Yeah. It misshaped you?
Misshapen. Yeah.
We didn't get quite that extreme.
Oh, we got something, though.
We did get something. We'll talk about giveaways.
Absolutely.
Hope parents aren't listening to this one.
That's my concern.
When you go into a film that is teasing some sort of something's wrong with the pregnancy, Rosemary's Baby-esque film, you don't expect the body horror that we get in this.
No, and I think we both came to that same realization that, wow, this kind of looks a little bit like Contracted.
I think a great compliment to Contracted. Did we do that for the show, or did we just...
God, I think we did.
I don't think we did the original Contracted.
Which I'm a fan of, and especially for sound design and the execution of practical decay of the actress. It doesn't go that extreme in this film, but something is wrong.
Very much wrong.
Who is our actress here, the main actress? Oh, God, foreign names. Cosmina Stratton?
I think that's right.
Alina?
She was really good.
Amazing performance.
Very, very good.
The first half of this movie is basically just a drama about a couple who can't have a baby in this once made turn to surrogate. And her emotional journey with these people and the regrets that she has. We get a lot of character development in the first third of the film while she's at this place. She's kind of in a desperate spot.
Yeah.
She needs money to have an apartment for her and her 5-year-old child who they were left by her husband.
Yeah, he sounded like a complete asshole.
Did we get all of these details through phone calls that she was making, or was she talking also with...
That was in a discussion with Louise in the boat.
I was just going to say a lot of it came out of those early discussions when they were kind of forming this bond.
The acting in this was fantastic. It was subtle. It was believable. You really, at least I really understood and appreciated the characters' motives, in particular Louise and Alina. They were very... I don't want to say relatable because these aren't situations I've been in, but you could really empathize with these characters.
Isn't that so funny? Because I could empathize with them, but the character I felt like I empathized the most with was Casper, the husband, father. The father. Yeah. Who, incidentally, if you look at the actor's IMDb page, he has a fantastic side man bun.
Ooh, fun.
Yeah. I've never seen somebody rock the side man bun. He was apparently in The Bridge. I didn't watch The Bridge, but he must have had a decent role. He was in like 4 episodes in season 2. Anyhow, I thought he did a really good job and was very much like trying to support his wife, watching his transition basically to like, holy shit, I can't do this anymore, was very authentic, I felt.
I think it goes beyond that when the more supernatural elements, which I think we're going to get into in Dead Giveaways. We're doing a Dead Giveaway.
Let's just do it. Yeah, let's just move into it.
Let's move into the darker side of this movie. It's time for Dead Giveaways.
Dead Giveaways.
This is the point in the show where we spoil a movie. If you don't want this movie ruined or, minimally affected, I highly recommend you pause and watch Shelley before continuing, and you can do that. This was a screener from IFC Midnight, so thank you, IFC Midnight, for that, but this is also available on all VOD platforms right now. All right, third act, Demon Seed.
Yeah.
Is that what we have here?
Yeah.
I think so.
Seems to be.
How did we get there?
Well, that's the part that I don't like not knowing the origin of the demon.
Well, do you think it had... So Louise has had multiple attempts at pregnancy that have all ended tragically. And then the final one, she also lost her womb, in her words, and is unable to have children at all anymore. So that's why they need the surrogate. You know, I'm wondering if it was something to do with Louise and like something inside her.
Or maybe there was some sort of spiritual intervention trying to keep her from having a child, and then implanting this in the surrogate just kind of unleashed.
They circumvented the protection.
Quite the loophole.
Yeah. I don't know. That was...
We could be looking too deeply at that.
Well, and that was possible. Where I started to struggle with the movie a little bit.
In terms of where the demon came from.
Yes.
Isn't there a moment where Elena walks in on Louise praying or doing something?
See, I think that was a dream, though.
Yeah.
Okay.
I kept thinking that there's got to be some reason for this, but anytime I felt that, then suddenly she would wake up and it was a dream.
It's a handful of not over-the-top dreams, but scary and effective.
And they prophetic. Were scary.
I both wanted an origin story for the demon, mm-hmm. and I wanted a more clear trajectory for the demon by the end.
No, I mean, I completely sympathize with that, but I do think that it's almost scarier if demons just attack weak
randomly.
People. When you're at your lowest, that's when demons supposedly attack you.
I guess so.
I do think, you know, we get a glimpse of the demon at two separate occasions, once in dreams and then once as...
Jon Snow.
As Jon Snow, yes. and winter's coming.
Yeah.
Louise is the only person who is not seeing that her baby is a demon. The baby kills Elena.
Technically, Elena kills Elena.
Well,
yeah, she tries to give herself a...
playing a game of hide.
Yeah, she tried to
knitting needle.
She tried to end the pregnancy right at the end. Didn't work.
She's Albert
Fishin.
She
ended up dying. The baby survived. They take the baby home. Casper, the dad, immediately knows something's wrong, and that builds. And then eventually, he tries to take the baby to do something with it
in some sort of trance.
Right. Louise, the wife/mother, reacts by slamming him in the car door until he's dead. And then that's just
not great.
Sitting and rocking with the baby, all creepy-like, still not understanding that there's a demon.
So Casper's in a trance, and Elena was also in a similar trance prior to her death and attempted abortion. Were they being possessed by good at this point? Because they're trying to stop the demon from being born.
See, I felt Elena was just really sick. I don't know that she was in a trance. I think she was just literally being overrun by this creature inside
of her. And she knew something was wrong. She said multiple occasions that something is wrong with this baby.
But it seemed like they both went into like self-preservation mode. You know, like they have to...
They were able to respond on a very instinctual level and know how bad this was, the thing they were facing.
I just thought that was very interesting. Because usually in a horror film, when people are in a trance, you think of them as the evil character, you know?
Yeah.
The potential for danger. But in this movie, they're actually trying to stop it. Did you shoot a gun with your face?
No, sorry. I tried to stifle a sneeze, which was just stupid.
Yeah, man. A lot of pretty intense scenes beyond this hide the needle, which I haven't squirmed that hard in a while.
Yeah, you were squirmy wormy.
I don't like this hidden needle thing.
So should we talk about the other thing also?
Yeah, man.
Why do we have to talk about that? Like, seriously, do we have to talk about that? Why would we talk about that?
There was an intense fisting.
If there's anybody who that would be intense for, it would be me. And
of
I don't
course.
Think it's even worth bringing up.
You don't see it very often in not... Those
it
kind
was
of
shocking.
Movies.
It was a shocking scene.
It's just kind of gross.
Yeah,
but
yeah.
It was like
one of those dream
gross.
Sequences.
You know, a bit more like Antichrist.
Yeah, a little bit Antichristy. I don't know. I just thought that caught us all off guard as well. It's worth pointing out.
I guess
maybe that doesn't mean as much to the Danish people, but
isn't von Trier Danish?
Yeah,
there you go.
The whole thing was very interesting, and it was executed very well. Cinematography was great. Lighting was really cool. And Sam, you mentioned earlier you really liked the outdoor shots. They're in a beautiful part of the world.
It's
very hard to fuck that up, you know.
So Byron, what would you give it then?
Me over here with all the things I've said so far.
Yeah,
I wasn't expecting much going in, and I got kind of a fun little arty film that made me think a lot more than I expected to. I liked it. I give it a 5.8.
Sam, what you got?
I really enjoyed this movie. I was kind of expecting it would be in my wheelhouse, and I was more than rewarded for that expectation. The sound really got to me too. There was this always a constant droning hum, kind of an insectile, not quite a buzz, but a tick, you know, we're led to believe is coming from this presence. And it was really effective. The acting was really well done. I am left with this image that I think is really cool. They lived in this self-contained house, basically. They have their own water. They have their own garden. They don't eat meat, so they don't need to worry about that. They have chickens for eggs. They have a landline, and that's it. That's the only contact with the outside world, and no one lives around there. So that last scene where Louise is sitting there rocking the baby and the demons, or the, you know, what the entity is standing behind him in the corner, I mean, you just know that she's going to be able to raise that child indefinitely before it finally is unleashed on the world. They're undisturbed in that kind of forgotten corner of the world. And I love that idea. So I'm going to give this movie a 6.8. It was a fun flick, and I definitely recommend it.
I really liked the beginning of this movie. The tone it was setting was really beautiful and kind of creepy. You weren't sure what direction it was going to go. You were trying to figure out the motives. I felt like the character development was pretty darn good. The story just fell a little short for me. It's so funny. I don't know why. Most of the time, I don't like having everything explained to me.
Questions.
I love the questions, but for some reason, it really nagged at me. Maybe I'm just in a weird mood.
Yeah.
But it nagged at me not to have the origin or the trajectory for this demon story.
Maybe you just
want
to make sure it doesn't happen to you.
Maybe that is it. Maybe I want a little bit more assurance that this baby's just fine. Yeah, so it certainly wasn't bad. I don't know that I'd watch it again. It was worthwhile for a watch once through. I'd give it a 5.0.
And those are our thoughts on the film Shelley, which you can check out. And I would love to hear your thoughts. Hit us up on Twitter at Frightday on Twitter. contact@frightday.com is our email address. Once again, thanks IFC Midnight for that screener. We really appreciate that as well.
More cool stuff from IFC Midnight in the pipe.
Oh my gosh, so many films coming out.
I think things we're excited about. There's I Am Not a Serial Killer.
Lloyd in that one.
Yeah, I know. Doc Brown. I'm sure he never, ever gets that anywhere he goes.
I guarantee you he doesn't. In Anti-Birth, which Kelly, I think you might dig. Why are we doing a bunch of pregnancy movies to begin with?
Can we not do anymore?
It's Chloe Sevigny.
She's cool. I still don't want to see another Prego movie.
She's great. She's been great in Bloodline.
Yeah, she has.
And also Devil Dolls.
Which I'm very much looking forward to. I don't know if you've seen the trailer. I posted it this week at Frightday.com.
It looks fun.
Looks like a lot of fun. Serial killer spirits possessing people. We got, you remember June, right?
Oh, yeah.
Kennedy Bryce from June.
Oh,
she's
cool.
She's in this film as well.
She's good.
A little bit of creepy kid stuff.
She's very good.
So we might be covering a handful of films from IFC Midnight in the near future.
I like it.
Check out all the trailers for those films at Frightday.com. Speaking of things that you should be checking out, we're all hanging out at our Facebook group, facebook.com/group/Frightday.
Absolutely.
Lots of fun conversation going in there. One of our writers just asked us a fun question. Do you hold your breath while driving past graveyards?
Totally.
You do?
Yep.
Really? I didn't know that.
I've never done that. What's that do?
I also hold my breath when going through tunnels.
Okay.
I also try to lift my feet off the floor of the car when going over state lines.
All right. I mean, maybe pay attention to the things you're doing.
It's a miracle that you're still alive.
You're making things a lot harder than they need to be. What is it? Body breath? Is that what you're breathing in?
I mean, I don't know.
Yeah, maybe that's a throwback from a time when the preservation techniques weren't as good and graveyards stunk real bad.
Could be.
And I don't want a spirit in my mouth.
Keep out, ghosts.
But yeah, I mean, join in the conversation. Facebook.com/group/Frightday. We're also on Instagram at Frightday, as well as Snapchat, which I've still yet to snap. I'd love to know what you want us to Snapchat.
Just tell us.
I'm not turning 30 at the end of the month. I'm doing just fine.
Maybe that's why you're having a whole meltdown.
If you like our show and want to help us make it even better, grab something spooky at shop.frightday.com. A couple of people have been grabbing our Art Bell pin.
Ugh. Only because it's the best pin that ever lived?
I have to say it's a rad pin.
Spreading the word of the greatest radio man there ever was.
May he come back someday to grace us all again with his audio presence.
And I have a couple new ideas for t-shirts, but until then, why don't you use the promo code ArtBell at shop.frightday.com to save 15%?
Whoa!
Sounds kind of
fun. Nothing like a deal.
But if things that everyone have access to aren't enough for you, you can go to patreon.com/frightday Mm-hmm. And grab our Patreon exclusive t-shirt, Summertime Stabness. Only a couple, less than 2 months left until that's gone forever. Check that out. And there's a handful of other things that you get for being a Patreon patron, like Captain Kelly's Cryptids and Conspiracies, which is available now. The latest episode.
Oh, yeah. Halls of Record.
Halls of Records.
No, Halls of Record.
Halls of Record?
No, I think it would be Halls of Records.
Multiple halls.
Multiple records.
Maybe.
Because otherwise, it would be the halls that are on record.
Kelly, what's a hall of record?
Well, there are many different halls, as it turns out, which you'll learn all about in my awesome episode. But a lot of it has to do with ancient knowledge and what might have come before us and who might have tried to preserve that knowledge for future generations.
So check that out.
Yeah.
Also, you have access to a pre-show hangout. What did we talk about this week?
I tried to talk about Michael Franti.
Uh-huh. Okay, so maybe don't tell them that or else they might not want to support us on Patreon.
One of these days, I'm going to play music, guys.
.com/Frightday. And most helpful of all, you can leave us a review at iTunes. That's the best way to get us up the charts in front of new eyes and really does mean a lot.
Now, I think would be an appropriate time to thank Daniel for his fantastic contribution.
Are you kidding me, Daniel?
Daniel.
A very generous supporter of us on Patreon. I really appreciate it.
Pretty.
That.
Thanks, man.
Awesome.
Don't know what we're doing next week, but it is going to be a spooky film. Until then, Kelly, where can we find you on the internet?
You can find me at Kelly Frightday on Twitter, or you can find me kelly@frightday.com by email.
Oh, and Kelly, it's that time again. You're collecting stories.
Collecting stories, yes. We're going to have another an October edition, True Tales of Terror, which is going to be really fun.
We want your ghost stories.
Yeah, honestly, I've got a few great ones. It's amazing the cool stories that listeners have sent us over the year, but we need more for this awesome episode.
kelly@frightday.com.
I'm at Sam Frightday on Twitter. Email me sam@frightday.com. Instagram, sam_Milodragovich.
And I'm at Byron McKoy. Byron@frightday.com is my email address. Guys, thank you so much once again. And until next Frightday, I'm Byron.
I'm Kelly.
And I'm Sam. Keep your eyes on the sky.